Hi. Hi, friends. It's me, the Sucky Seamstress. Welcome to my not a show sewing vlog. I don't know if you watched my last vlog from yesterday, but I really wanted chocolate cake. And let me tell you, handsome hubby absolutely came through. When he came home from work today, he was burying chocolate cake. It is delicious, and I love it. More chocolate cake later. Again, during this video, I am going to be fanning myself because it is extremely hot in here. I tried filming again, turning my little box fan this way and that, but it's just so loud in the background. One very nice update is we did get the portable AC unit from my amazing friend who has given it to us, and we tested it out on our window, and this amazing cold air came out of it, and we just stood in front of it and went, oh, this is so wonderful. And we've decided we're going to put it upstairs in our bedroom because it is the hottest room in the house. I mean, the downstairs is bearable if you're like, have the box fan pointed at you. But the upstairs is an oven, especially our bedroom. Also, hopefully I'll be starting work so soon. I did hear back on a job and they sound really positive. So again, fingers crossed for me, please. George loves to stay. The bedroom is his favorite place. The bed is his favorite place in the house. And since the bedroom gets so warm, then we can put the little AC unit up there and it can be a fan until the room gets too hot, and then the AC can kick in and keep him nice and cool when I'm gone at work. We used to put him in a kennel when we were at work, but he just hates it. He just hates it. And he's an old puppy, and he just does not deserve to sit in a hot, yucky kennel. I mean, I had this little fan that I pointed at it, but he doesn't deserve that. He loves our bed. Like today I went and had brunch with my dear friend Rebecca and her adorable and lovely mother. Hi, Rebecca's mom, who is also one of the 8 people who loves me, and watches my videos, and our super talented photographer friend, Rachel, from Rachel E. Jones Photography. I will verify that and get to you. Anyway, what was I saying? Oh, we had a late brunch date with all the girls today, and it was so fun. And I just put a boy puppy diaper. They're really interesting. They're just like a big wide band that you put around and they stick together on the top, and you put it around his nether region underneath, and it sticks around him just kind of like a belt around the lower half of him, because he has been sporadically having just little drip issues. So we bought those for any time we're not home, because that's when it's been happening. And I just left him out in the house, which is not something we've been very familiar with. And when I came home, I heard him jump off the bed upstairs. So, and that's what tends to happen. He just loves hanging out on the bed upstairs. I think it probably smells the most like me and a handsome hubby, and it's the most comfortable place for him to lay down in bed. And there's a big box fan in the window that blows air constantly over the bed. So I think he keeps cool up there for the most part. This is not anything I was going to talk about, but as you know me, tangents. Okay. Where was I? This is part two. There's going to be a part three and quite possibly a part four of July and my LA trip. I might also cough because I am getting over bronchitis. Still, I still have a little bit of a cough, a little bit of a stuffy nose, and I am still taking medication for a sinus infection. So I'm a mess. Oh, I spilled honey on my dress. My gosh, I can't keep anything clean. Roar! It's kind of a joke, honestly, with me and my friends and my husband and my family. And well, pretty much anyone who knows me, that it's pretty much a given that I'm going to spill on myself whenever I eat. So I have taken to tucking napkins when I go to restaurants just directly into my cleavage to protect my clothes. Doesn't matter if I'm wearing costumes or regular clothes or anything. It's just, I'm going to spill on myself and I'm going to just preemptively protect that. And I should take pictures. At the end of meals, my napkins are just like smeared and stuff because apparently I don't know how to eat properly. Okay, so I left off the Tuesday I arrived in LA and went straight from the airport to the hotel, dropped off bags, picked up friend Melinda, and then we went to Universal Studios. Now, I haven't been to Universal Studios LA in many, many, many years, and I forgot how sprawled out it is. I mean, there's like upper lot and lower lot, and they're so far away and you have to walk so far between them that there's like escalators to go up and down the hill to like get to them. And even with the escalators, it's so much walking and it's so hot and the rides are like really far apart from each other. And I didn't remember all of that. There was very little shade outside, and what little shade there was very little seating in the shade, and what very little seating there was in the shade was completely taken up. So that was really hard on us. I would say the hardest part was, though, I didn't fit on like half the rides in the park. And the worst thing is you wait in line. You get on the ride and then they're like, oh, this doesn't go down far enough that this like color thing on the thing shows. So you can't ride the ride. So then you have to get out of the ride in front of everyone and leave, which I was sitting there. I actually filmed a little video clip that I'm going to try to edit in just a second. But after like the third time, I was standing outside looking around and I'm like, I am by far not the biggest person here at the park. There are much bigger people here today, which means there are so many people that come to this park who cannot ride these rides. And honestly, Universal Studios LA doesn't have that many rides. Like if you compare it to like Disneyland, it really doesn't have a ton of rides. And the best rides are the ones that people don't fit on. I mean, you know, for example, the part of the park that we don't like to mention, but that we love, the castle. Yeah, couldn't go on that ride. I don't even remember all the rides I couldn't go on, but yeah, I was so bummed. I couldn't go on the Life of Pets. Like, it's basically a dinky, you know, at Disneyland, those little rides that's like the story of Snow White, the story of Pinocchio. It's like one of those rides for small children and their parents. Yeah, I couldn't get on that ride. And when I couldn't get on that ride, I was like fuming. I was like, this is ridiculous. And the guy was like, did someone point out to you the seat to test to see if you fit in it outside. And I was like, no, no one pointed this out to me. Anyway, I'm going to tell you about that experience in this little video clip that I filmed right out after that experience happened on the park. I look awful because I had sweated like all my makeup off and my hair is like slicked back with sweat and sunscreen. And I have like, I wear this white shawl thing on my head a lot when I'm going to be out in the sun to protect like my ears and my neck and down here because I burn right through sunscreen. So that's kind of what the white shawl thing you see is. Okay. Future Emily, insert that edit right here.
I just had to walk away from my third ride that couldn't fit closed down around my big fat belly. You know, it's embarrassing. It's You pay a lot of money to come here, and I'm looking around and I'm seeing so many people who are plus sized, including many people who are bigger than me, and I'm just having a day. So hopefully, I mean, the guy was kind of nice and he handed me some like a little voucher thing. But he was like, the way, I was like, oh, this is going to be like some special little voucher, you know. And he's like, this voucher is good for these four rides, which are more size inclusive. And I'm just like, four rides on the park, which are size inclusive. And one of them is a show. So, yeah, I'm guessing today is not going to be my favorite day on this trip. And it's just, it's sad because I've noticed that Disney has been much more size inclusive with their rides, and Universal just hasn't made an effort, like, especially with how expensive tickets are and, you know, how long you wait in lines for some of these rides and stuff, and then to be told, oh, I'm sorry, this doesn't go down as far as we want it to, for it to go down safely. And I'm like, it clicked in place, but yeah, I'm not gonna get petty. I'm just saying, frustration, so much frustration, my friends.
Did it work? Did I do it? I hope so. Editing has been not great lately. I'm hoping once I get started into a job and finances are not so tight, maybe I can actually invest in a camera of some kind. I used to have a handy cam. I don't know if you know what those are. It was a great little camcorder that was like camcorder for dummies. It was so easy to use for those who are not tech savvy. And I still have it somewhere. Though I'm sure it doesn't work with anything anymore. But I loved it because it was so easy to use. And I wonder if they have the equivalent out now because my phone is just, it's just not doing well as a vlogging camera anymore, really. I mean, with it stopping after 30 minutes, it's like the storage is completely full over and over again. It's lots of issues. The editing it's not great. And when I say editing, I mean like putting this piece next to this piece or cutting out the part at the beginning when I like push record and then remember that I forgot something and run off screen and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, I do edit that stuff out, but I don't edit like, well, you know, I don't edit in the middle of my videos because don't edit. It leaves time for more mistakes. Okay, tangent over. So Universal Studios was, honestly, it kind of felt like a waste of money. It did. other than the fact that I had super fun time hanging out with my friend Melinda, it was not great. The new Super Mario Land was very cute and very, very cute. It's very small, but it's super, super cute. There's a million photo ops everywhere. But unless you pay a bunch of money for this like special band thing that only is interactive in that section of the park, you can't interact with any of the cute stuff in that area of the park. So that was kind of lame. And then we waited for over 2 hours to ride the new Bowser ride. Yeah. And we had paid for like the special, when we originally got our tickets to the park, we paid for the special, like, I don't know what they're called, lightning lanes or whatever they're called now. I mean, I think that's the Disney term, but you know, where like you get to go one at Universal, it's for every ride once you get to go in the like fast pass lane or something like that. But it didn't apply to the new Bowser ride. So we waited for over 2 hours, and it's cute once you get into the castle portion because there's things to look at and stuff. But yeah, it was 2 hours on your feet in the hot sun, screaming children, and just, it was so annoying. And then you get on the ride, and the ride, you put this like halo thing that has to like squeeze onto your head. And then you get into the little ride thing, and it's got this visor that attaches to that halo. And then you're riding around this ride. If you've been to Disneyland and you've ridden the Buzz Lightyear ride where you shoot at aliens and stuff, it's kind of like that. So you're shooting, but you aim where you look because the visor thing is projecting like the images of the characters in front of you. And it's kind of the images it's projecting are kind of like, it's like 3D images, and you're kind of in the like Mario Kart racing. So there's Mario and his friends, and then there's Bowser and his minions, you know, and you're trying to only hit Bowser and his minions and not Mario and his friends. And and so, I mean, it's kind of fun. It's fun. It's a cute ride, and it's really interesting technology, but it was not worth 2.5 hours. Like, it was not worth, I wouldn't even wait an hour for that ride, honestly. So, I mean, that's my 2 cents, but take it or leave it, but it was, yeah, not worth it. And the food we ate, we ate at the little, like Toadstool Cafe there. And it was decent food. It wasn't amazing. It's a very cute cafe. It's got these screens of like the little Toadstool guy village. And every now and then this like, there like thunder and lightning happens in the cafe. And like this pirate ship from the air is like attacking the mushroom village. It was very cute. But that was cuter than the food was good, if that makes sense. So I don't know. Okay, so after that, we went back to the hotel, and that was Tuesday night. Wednesday, I was supposed to go to Huntington Gardens. I had months and months earlier planned with some friends who live in LA to go to Huntington Gardens. And we had tea reservations and in the new restored tea room. And we were going to go to the gardens and the museums and stuff. I've never been there, so I'm not sure what all is there. But I was so excited to go, and we were going to dress up. And they all bailed about a month and a half before costume college. So... And all of my friends already had other plans and weren't really interested in going. So I decided I was just going to go by myself, and I was going to go to tea by myself and dress up by myself and go. Well, after walking around all day on Tuesday in the hot, hot sun, and I was on my feet all day, and I was still kind of upset by the whole ride situation, I totally canceled my plans and decided I was just going to hang out in the hotel and chillax, because I, didn't want to deal with, oh my gosh, my husband just started the Xbox, even though I'm down here filming, and it's making a bunch of noise, so hang on just a second. Ooh, he's in so much trouble. He's in so much trouble. He didn't even check. I told him I was going to be down here filming. He didn't even check. That makes me mad. I'm going to have to eat some chocolate cake. It was really cute. When I was at brunch today, Rebecca's mom was like, I watched your video and I really want a chocolate cake. I was like, I know, right? Somehow I got on this tangent about chocolate cake, and then all I could think about was chocolate cake. So I hope those of you who are like, chocolate cake, got some chocolate cake, because chocolate cake is delicious. So. I don't know. What was I talking about? Oh. So Wednesday. It turned out to be pretty good that I stayed back and just chilled at the hotel anyway, because we had to leave. George, can you just lay down? Why is everyone bothering me while I'm filming today? Just lay down. He's tap, 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 tap this way. Tap, 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 tap that way. Tap, 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 tap. Just lay down. Mama's trying to film. Oh my gosh, household. Mama's trying to film for like 2 seconds. These men, I tell you, these bullies, they're driving me insane. Like, 2 seconds. I need 2 seconds. I have a husband and a dog, and yet I can't get no relief. I don't know how y'all with children manage, because I feel like I have two of them, and they're driving me crazy. Okay. So, it turned out to be a good thing, because we were leaving at like 4 o'clock, I think. It was at 4 o'clock we decided to leave to go to the Magic Castle. I know. If you don't know what the Magic Castle is, the Magic Castle is this Edwardian home that, well, it's an Edwardian house that was built in the the late Victorian style, up in the Hollywood Hills, that was purchased in the 60s, I believe it was. I may not have my timelines right, but it was the 80s. I'm not sure. Anyway, it was purchased and turned into a professional magician's private club called the Magic Castle. And they restored a lot of it. George, go lay down. Mama said you have to stay laying down until she's done videoing. No more tap, tap, tap. Oh, I love you. I love you. Just lay down. Lay down with your teddy bear. Okay. Lay down with your penguin. Okay. Stay. Don't make me use mom voice. Okay. I think he's confused because I'm just standing here and he doesn't really understand what it means when I just stand here. And he knows that dad's upstairs and the fan is off and he's like, what is going on? Anyway, so Magic Castle. So a lot of it was restored to, its original, Victorian glory, with all, like, they uncovered, like, a lot of the original wood had been, like, painted over and stuff, and they took all that, and it's all the original beautiful wood, and just beautiful, beautiful, this house is gorgeous. And then, and it's like a, I think it's a 4-story house. And they added like stairs this way and stairs that way and secret passageways and and little theater rooms, little stages all over the house, and then one big stage area, and then there's a restaurant on one of the floors, and every floor has a bar, and it's just, it is so cool. And you can only go if you have to make a reservation, and you can only make a reservation if you have a recommendation from a professional magician who is a member at the Magic Castle. Now, me and my friend Melinda made friends, well, acquaintances, but hopefully in the future friends, with a professional magician during the Victorian Heritage Festival this last year. And he had mentioned that if we're ever in LA, we can contact him if we want to make reservation at the Magic Castle. So we did. And we got this reservation. And we had originally gotten it for 6 people, but it turned out some of our friends weren't interested. Oh, okay. Sorry. That was a bottle. There's a bunch of these hanging around right now because handsome hubby was sitting over here when I was over on the couch because we were quarantining from each other because he had COVID. Well, first I had COVID, but then he had COVID, so we were quarantining. And he said something that made me mad. And I had a bunch of these bottles that he had gotten me drinks for electrolytes. And so I started throwing them at him like they were magic spells and shouting out what the magic spells were. And then he was laughing really hard, and then I was laughing really hard. But now there's all of these bottles over here, and I'm sitting on the table, and they're falling. That was a really long explanation. I am sorry. So, Magic Castle. So we made a reservation. We had an 8 o'clock dinner reservation, and then tickets for the 10 o'clock big magic show that's on the main stage. Please excuse me. But they recommend getting there when the doors open at 5, because then you can explore the house, you can go to any of the little stage shows that happen all during the night and see a bunch of little acts. There's a little gift shop, there's lots of secrets to discover and explore. It is so cool. Now, I took some pictures of the outside of the house, and then there's like an outside picture area that we got pictures with our bunch of friends. And then we did get pictures. I know I posted a picture with me and Melinda and our other friend in the entryway. There's an entry room where you go up to the hostess desk and, you know, check in for your reservation. The gift shop's off to the side. And it's this beautiful, beautifully decorated little entry room. That is the only room you can take pictures or video in the entire house. Once you magically enter the house from that room, that's all I'm going to say, you can no longer pull out your phone and take pictures and video. In fact, if they see you like pull out your phone to text or whatever, not only do, you know, people who work there kind of frown at you and like, they're like, what are you doing? But everyone around you will frown at you, because this is like a pure experience that everyone wants to remain a pure experience, which is amazing. They actually say, if you need to make a phone call, go into the bathroom, which I thought was really cool. I love the idea of keeping the mystery, the air of mystery around the place. It was beautiful. I saw 4 stage shows, I think, if you include the main stage show that night. And in one of them, I got to be the assistant. I know. Okay, so let me explain this really quick, and then I'm going to have to like stop and restart. I love magic. I love magicians. I love magic shows. I love it. I am one of those people whose brain usually can't figure out how a trick is done, and I am 100% happy and fine with that. In fact, Handsome Hubby is one of those people who can figure them out or wants to figure them out. So he'll sit there and try to figure it out. And then he wants to tell me. And I'm like, no, no, no. Don't you dare tell me how this trick was done. I would like to continue thinking that it was magic. Now, this female magician, I don't remember her name off the top of my head, and I will need to dig out my program. But she was beautiful, first of all. She was beautiful in this red dress and everything. She just had this amazing stage presence. She was so amazing. She was young, but so amazing with the crowd and the people. And she did this trick, this like disappearing ring trick that I was kind of a part of. And then she did the floating table trick. And I've seen the floating table trick done before, which is where the magician holds, so it's a little table, and there's a tablecloth over it, like a square tablecloth, and the magician holds two corners, and they have an audience member hold the other two corners, and then they float the table. And I've always thought it was really cool, but I'm going to admit that my brain has been like, I bet the magician's side has like something attached to the table, or like, you know, like metal things or wires or whatever. So she's like, we're going to float the table. And I was like, yes, I love this trick so much. And I'm holding, you know, my two sides, and I'm like trying to covertly, you know, not let the audience or her know what I'm doing, but I'm sure they could tell. I'm like feeling the fabric. I'm like, is there anything going on my side? No, this is just a wimpy little decorated tasseled tablecloth, you know? And then she tells the table to float, and the table floats up, and I'm just like, you know, getting tons of goosebumps because this is so, so cool. And she's like, go ahead and let go of one side and, you know, pass your hand over the table. And I'm like, really? Okay. And I'm passing my hand over. And I'm like, oh, okay, nothing's there. And she's like, go ahead and lift it up and look under the tablecloth. And I'm like, okay, thinking I'm just going to lift it up on my side. She lifts. I can see completely under the tablecloth all the way to this woman. Like, I'm like, oh, that is her dress. There's, and I'm like glancing around going, there's nothing there. There is nothing there. There was nothing under the tablecloth. There was nothing under the tablecloth. If you know how this trick is done, don't you dare tell me how it's done, because I will be so mad at you. It was amazing. I felt like a magical assistant princess. Part of that was also because of how I was dressed. The Magic Castle, it is mandatory evening dress, which is awesome. So like, we're waiting. We got there super early, and we're like at 4:30, and we're waiting outside in the shade. They had a great waiting area, kind of. And people are starting to show up in the most expensive cars I've ever seen in my life. I don't know much about cars, but I know these cars are like more worth more money than I probably made in my entire life combined. And like, these men are stepping out in like these like suits that are like super fancy, and these women are in these like glamorous gowns and like jewels, and I'm like, I'm betting those are real, you know. And anyway, but there was a full mix at this place. Like, I was walking right by and even talked to some of these really high-priced looking people. And I love that just anyone and everyone goes to the Magic Castle and experiences magic. I swear we saw a famous person there. I'm not going to say, because I'm going to feel stupid if that's not who it was. But we were all kind of like, is that who we think it is? Anyway, the dinner was like this gourmet dinner. Very, very expensive, but very, very yummy gourmet dinner. It really is like a once-in-a-lifetime experience that I'm hoping to repeat next year. Okay, I'm going to stop and start a new video because we know my phone can't handle this. And we're back! So one really fun thing about the Magic Castle was, because we had two friends drop out and we were having trouble filling those seats, we were asking friends, you know, hey, do you want to go to Magic Castle with us Wednesday night? But a lot of our costume college friends were not showing up until Thursday, which is Thursday nights actually when costume college starts. So we were having trouble finding people. And I went downstairs to check into my room with the concierge. And because I was sharing my friend Melinda's room, because her roommate hadn't shown up yet, it was a whole thing. Or maybe I wasn't checking into my room. What was I doing? I was doing something downstairs at the main desk. I don't know. I was waiting in line at the main desk to ask a question. It might have been about the AC. There were some AC issues that weekend. And I got to talking to the lady behind me in line, found out she was there for costume college. She was from DC, or New York. No, I think it was DC. I'm pretty sure it was DC. And that she had found out about costume college when someone had won a ticket there at, during a cosplay contest at a convention. And she was like, ooh, what's that? And looked it up. And she's like, I want to go to that. And so she came to the other side of the United States, didn't know anyone. And I was like, hey, what are you doing tonight? And she was like, oh, I don't have any plans. And I was like, do you maybe want to go to the Magic Castle? And she was like, are you kidding me? Are you have what? You're going to the Magic Castle and you want me to come? What? And I was like, yeah, do you want to come with us? She's like, well, I didn't really bring like nice clothes. And I was like, I have dresses and belts. We will put you in a dress and a belt and you will come with us. So we made a whole new friend and that is awesome. And she came with us and looked amazing and we all had so much fun. And I love meeting new friends that way. Talk to the people around you. You never know when you're going to meet an awesome new friend. Thursday night, I moved into my room, and in with my roommate. This year I roomed with a lady that I've only met once. I met her at the Victorian Festival. Things got a little mixed up with costume college this year. I think I talked about in a previous video, but originally I wasn't going to go. Then my friend Rebecca convinced me to go, and I wasn't going to room with Rebecca. Then Rebecca convinced me to room with her. Then Rebecca decided she wasn't going to go to costume college because she was going to do a play. And so I panicked, went to the Victorian Festival and said, hey, is anyone going to costume college and doesn't have a roommate? Because I'm panicking now that I don't have a roommate because I hate leaving that up in the open because I can't afford a room by myself. And this awesome lady that I talked to during the tea was like, I don't have a roommate, I'll room with you. And I was like, great. And then Rebecca ended up not doing the play and saying, oh, I'm gonna go to costume college now. I was like, okay, great. But I was excited to like make a new friend through this roommate. I've actually had a different roommate every year of costume college. My first year of costume college was 2018. I'd meant to go previous to that, but I'd just always been like a little afraid. And what if my costumes aren't good enough? And what if I, you know, get overwhelmed? And I'll tell you, you won't. They are, and you won't, because there's every level of costuming. Some people come to costume college without costumes. They just want to come, enjoy what everyone else is wearing, and go to classes. I mean, there's every level of everything at costume college. Just saying. So that first year, I convinced two friends to come with, well, one was already going, but another friend to room with me, and we drove from Utah to costume college. And me and that friend actually stayed in a different hotel that was like half the price. When costume college was in Woodland Hills. And, you know, I don't actually recommend that, because even though that hotel was so much cheaper, there is something about staying at the hotel and just experiencing being around everyone, being able to go straight to your room from classes and events and stuff. It's just, it's so much more worth it. But We had a lot of fun. She didn't end up going back to costume college. So the next year, I did the roommate finder that they do for costume college and roomed with complete stranger Emily, who is now one of my friends. And then that was 2019. And then 2022 or whenever the last time they did it in person, I went with, I roomed with Lady Rebecca Fashions, which was, you know, awesome because she's my friend. And, you know, when I roomed the year before, when I roomed in 2019, I made a new friend, but I also spent a lot of time like hanging out with my friends in their rooms because she was also hanging out with her friends in her rooms. And then the next time they had in-person costume college, I roomed with Lady Rebecca Fashions. So we hung out together in our room and then friends came to visit us there. So this year I figured, you know, gonna get to know new roommate, but I will probably go hang out with Rebecca and my friend Melinda, who is rooming with them, rooming with her in their room a lot. Turns out that didn't happen. It was just kind of a weird year. They kind of kept to themselves in their room and my roommate had a completely different like schedule. I'm used to friends like, hey, what classes are you going to? Let's compare notes. Let's talk about what we're doing. Let's get ready together. Let's help each other get ready. And none of that happened this year. So I will admit that I had a little bit of, more than a little bit of loneliness at costume college this year. It was also very spread out, but I'm getting ahead of myself. So Thursday, a Thursday day, we had this big outing. By we, I mean me, Rebecca, Melinda, who goes by Ribbon Chan on Instagram, Yosa, which goes by Yosa Adis on Instagram. I think I'm gonna tag them in the description. And Yosa's friend, whose name just escaped my brain and flew away. I will figure that all out. Anyway, we came up with this great idea to go out to the Queen Mary ship in Long Beach, which is a 1930s, a 1930s ship, a 1930s ship that is reminiscent of ships like the Titanic and the Carpathia and, you know, and, had a lot of Art Deco grandeur and all of that. And we decided that we were going to each recreate one of Rose's dresses from the Titanic movie, with Rebecca recreating what is known as the sink dress or the running dress, but more oftenly the sink dress, which is the pastel layered dress that she wears after her and Jack va-va-boomed and end up running through the hallways to get away from the bad guys. And then she's wearing it as the ship goes down. And then Melinda wears what is known as the first look dress. And it is the lovely, it's like a green, almost like an acidy green kind of underlayer. And then it's layered over with just layers and layers of lace in the skirt. And it's got this kind of burnt orangey red belt with a flower. And it's so pretty. And it's from when Rose is has gone out to get a breath of air to get away from the oppression of her mother and her fiance and, well, everybody. And she's leaning on the deck and Jack's sitting below and sees her for the first time and just sees this like beautiful redhead in lace, you know, standing above him. And she's kind of like, you know, why is this man looking at me like what is going on? Yeah, we knew she knew. We knew she knew she was pretty. So that's what Melinda made. She made this gorgeous reproduction of it and even wore a red wig that she had done up in Rose's hairstyle, which is commitment because it was hot. So wearing a wig was like full-on commitment. Yosa recreated what is known as the elevator dress. It is lesser known, and that is really sad. There is this tiny, tiny scene where Rose is getting off the elevator. The Titanic had an elevator. Getting off the elevator with her mom, and they're passing by Molly Brown. And the over-narration by, you know, old Rose is that they're talking about new money, the difference between old money and new money. And that dress, I found out from Yosa in the movie, was actually an actual 19-teens extant dress that they had found. And they just fixed it up a little bit and added that beautiful red satin belt with the, or red silk belt with the flower to it. But it's this black and white, like chiffon layered dress. It's so pretty. It's so sad that it's in the movie for like 2 seconds. And if you look up the costumes from the movie and you, they did these test photos of Kate Winslet in a lot of these costumes, that dress, oh wait, is that the one? That's not the one. Never mind. Scratch that. That was Melinda's dress, the green dress. Actually had this gorgeous hat that went with it, but the director decided he didn't like the way the hat went with the scenes and didn't think Rose would wear a hat with that dress. And let's not make things historical, shall we? Anyway, so Yosa recreated that dress and looked absolutely stunning. And then her friend, whose name I'm going to remember and I'm going to put in the description with everyone else's, decided to make the robe, which really doesn't need a name. I guess we could call it the Draw Me Like One of Your French Girls robe. The black robe with those beautiful long draping sleeves and the paisley giant peach. George, go lay down. He's trying to sneak past me. Like, he's trying to be sneaky. He, like, very slowly is taking one step after another. No being sneaky. Lay down and stay there. Giant paisley, like, peachy paisley designs. Oh, so pretty. And then she wore this, like, kind of peachy pink slip dress under it, you know, for modesty's sake, obviously. I was supposed to create the flying dress, which we all know it's the blue velvet on top, blue satin below, dress that Rose wears when they stand at the front of the ship and she says, I'm flying, Jack, Jack, I'm flying. The closer it got to costume college, the more and more I was panic sewing and the more mistakes I was making and the worse things were getting. And I finally said, this is not fun. I am not enjoying this. I don't want to feel like this. And I messaged my friends and was like, I'm not going to get this done. Because if I do try to get this done, it's just going to be awful. The fit's going to be awful. Everything's going to be bad. And Rebecca recommended that I just bring the 1909 dress that I just recently made for an event. Because it actually fits from like 1909 to 1911. The pattern, and which pretty much slides into to the Titanic era. And I have this lovely black Titanic era hat that I had bought from Atlee or Mella. We'll also put in the description. Last year at costume college, that she based on the pattern of the hat, Rose's embarkment hat, that big gorgeous purple hat she wears with her white and purple pinstripe suit outfit, that she based on that. So I was like, so I could go and wear a Rose-esque outfit. So, and honestly, I think in that heat, I was probably the most comfortable out of all of us because my outfit was 100% cotton. It had a 100% cotton lining, and then the over part is 100% cotton embroidered cotton. And so, you know, I had a very breathable dress, which was super nice. The one thing I did not anticipate is, you know, I kept trying to like tip the hat down strategically the way Rose had it. And I also had it hat pins in it to pin it to my hair, which I also tried to copy Rose's hair from the embarkment stills from the photo. And it cast my face in shadow in so many of the pictures. So at one point I took the hat pins out and put them in my bag and I started taking the hat off for some of the photos just so I'd have a couple of photos where my face was not in shadow. I definitely got the tilt of the hat better than I did the last time I wore it, but I'm still not sure I've got it quite right. I think I need to practice some more. We had so much fun on the ship. It's a beautiful ship. If you ever go out there, take the tour. The tour guides are so knowledgeable. The ship is so beautiful to tour. It's so fun to see the gorgeous Art Deco decor, the warm woods. They can tell you about what each of the woods are. They had different wood for different rooms. And then we had lunch in like this one of the little cafes. There's like three restaurants on board of varying fancinesses. And it was delicious. And we just had so much fun and took so many pictures. Once we were done at the Queen Mary, me, Rebecca, and Melinda split from Yosa and her friend, whose name I can't remember, and drove all the way to the other side of LA where we went to the Titanic exhibition experience. Ooh, what was it called? It was either called the Titanic Experience or the Titanic Exhibition. I feel like it was maybe the Titanic Exhibition. I will also get that right and put that in the description. Anyway, it was really cool. When we walked in, this lovely gentleman met us with a trumpet and loved our outfits and played My Heart Will Go On his trumpet. I have posted that on my Instagram. Please go watch it. It's beautiful. It was so smooth. I grew up with my little brother trying to play the trumpet. It never sounded like that. Then we were getting pictures taken of us in front of the big Titanic sign when this lady and this guy came over and were like, can we get pictures with you? And there were like people with them and they wanted pictures. Turns out they are like influencers, like big time influencers in LA that go to different things and then like write about them or talk about them on their videos. Once I see it posted, I will link it so you can see who and what I'm talking about. Then we went through the exhibition and it was really, really cool. They had little areas set up and like blocked off so you can bother them. Like set up like a first class lounge room with actual, like a few actual extant pieces. They had original china from the White Star lines that never made it onto the ship, but you know. And then they actually did have a few pieces of excavated items from the Titanic, which was really cool to see. And they, as you walked around, it took you through the story from the very beginning, from like the ship being built all the way through till like the very end. At the very end, they had a very quiet little spot with a plaque in honor of those who just recently lost their lives, you know, diving to go look at the Titanic wreck. But it was really amazing. They had some really cool photo spots. They had some really thought-provoking things. I took this picture of this gigantic wall that showed everyone who lost their lives on the Titanic, and it listed them under what they were. So, like, these were the first class passengers, second class, third class, and then the people who, oh, and then the officers who are on board, and then, like, all the workers on board. And, like, it got progressively bigger. Like, first class, the people who lost their lives in first class were tiny. A second class got bigger. Third class was huge. And then you got to the officers and the people who worked on board. And you realize that practically everyone who worked on board the Titanic lost their lives. Because they were never allowed to go on the boats. They were never allowed. I mean, they weren't even a thought. It was save the passengers. It wasn't save the workers. And do you know how many workers are on a boat that big? I mean, going from the bottom all the way up. It was astounding how many workers lost their lives. Like, out of the total of people who lost their lives, like, probably 75% were people who worked on that boat. It was really touching. It was really, really touching. And I'm really glad we went. It was really cool to see it all and to experience. They had a little gift shop, but I didn't really love... I was looking for something, like, special. I was hoping to find, like a teacup or something like that. But their stuff was very mainstream, like water bottles and sweatshirts and, you know, stuff like that, where I was hoping to find kind of maybe something more refined and something Titanic-ish. So I actually didn't end up buying anything from the Titanic exhibition, but from the Queen Mary. We know how much I love mugs, so I bought a new mug. It says the Queen Mary on it, and it's shaped like a smokestack. Do not adjust your screen. Yes, it is leaning. It's leaning because I don't know if you've noticed, but on those big ships, I'm sorry, it's like my circle is glaring on it, but, oh, there we go. The smokestacks on the ships kind of lean this way. They don't stand straight up. They kind of lean this way. So the whole mug leans. I don't know if you can see that, but I thought that was really cool. They had other ones, but I really like the smokestack mug. Then from the Queen Mary, I also got this, which I'm hoping to maybe turn to, I might turn it into a Christmas ornament. I'm not sure. I just loved it so much. It's a keychain, and it's got a little heft. It's solid. It's got heft. And it's this cute little teapot. And then on the back, it has this little emblem that says Queen Mary, Long Beach, California, and has a little emblem of the Queen Mary. But, like, something like this is what I was hoping to find at the Titanic experience. And I was really bummed that I didn't find something more genteel at the experience. And then at the Magic Castle, I got another mug because, come on, we all know I love mugs. I love tea. So I got this mug. They had mugs that just said Magic Castle, you know, and whatever. But again, I like the really fun mugs. So I'll explain why this mug is the way it is in a minute. So it says, always with you, love Irma, the Magic Castle. And then, well, this side just looks blank. When you put a hot beverage in it, this picture appears. And the picture is kind of dark, and it looks like almost like an oil and water type effect. And it shows a piano and a ghostly woman sitting at it. And that is because in one of the lounges at the Magic Castle, there is a piano that plays music. It is not a player piano. And from everything you can see, there are no wires going to it. There is nothing that appears to be making the piano play itself. the player piano, or the magically playing piano, takes requests, and it seems to know every song. Apparently, no song has been able to stump it. And there is a whole, like, lore behind it that it is the ghost of Irma. I'm not going to go into the story because this is something you should discover for yourselves and find a way into the Magic Castle. Thursday night was the first night of Costume College. And the first event... Sorry, my nose itches really bad. And the first event of Costume College, which used to be called Thursday Night Pool Party, I believe, I'm not 100% sure on this, it wasn't super clear. I believe it's been called, it is now called the Thursday Night Welcome Party. But it's usually held out on the patio by the pool, at least it was in Woodland Hills. And they also held it out on the patio by the pool at the new hotel. The new hotel is a hotel that is right next to the airport, which is super great because instead of getting like an hour, 45 minute to hour long taxi, Uber, Lyft, whatever, out to the hotel, you hop on a shuttle and 5 minutes later you're at the hotel from the airport. And that was super, super great. The pool area, though, the patio is small. Like, the patio area is small for a party. I noticed people coming, looking around, and leaving. And some people came in, kind of did one circle, and then they left. Because it was just, we were, like, packed like sardines in this corner of the pool patio. So, I don't know if that's something they might think about relocating next year, but it was really tight over there. The theme was the Enchanted Forest. It was the Enchanted something. The overall theme for Costume College this year was fairy tales and I'm not prepared. It was like fairy tales and costuming and cosplay, and it was just super open, which is always nice. And you can always choose to dress to the themes or not at all. Lots of people choose not to go with the themes at all and wear whatever they want. In fact, a lot of people just choose to wear the costumes that they made throughout the year. No matter if they match themes or don't match, like, that's not their goal. And that is fine. Everyone is perfectly happy for people to wear whatever they want. People also create costuming groups, which is super fun. There was a group of mushrooms that was adorable. We actually did a little group. We wore our 18th century pastorals that we made for a picnic that I hosted. Well, I wouldn't say I hosted it, but I kind of pulled it together and made it happen a few months ago. Me, Rebecca, Melinda, and Yosa. We actually found out Yosa was making a pastoral and was like, Yosa, join us. So we all wore our pastorals Thursday night and made an adorable group. And then we found another young lady who had also made a pastoral and worn it. And so we're like, come stand with us. Come be with us. And we all looked magical and adorable. And I rediscovered something that I have to constantly rediscover. It's okay not to be the best. For some reason, I think some costumers get it into their head that if they don't have the best costume, if their costume isn't just, you know, the best one there, or isn't the best one out of their group, or isn't the prettiest one, or the flashiest one, or isn't getting the most attention, then they've somehow failed. This is not true. All costumes in all of their forms add to the whole. My costume was by far the lowest in quality of my group. It just was. It so was. It was the lowest in quality. I am still just barely figuring out 18th century costuming. I used the wrong pattern for the bodice part and just tried to finagle it. And sometimes that works. This time it did not. But that's okay. I still looked super cute and I loved being dressed up with my friends and I still matched the group and that's happy. That's wonderful. That's beautiful. That's joy. I didn't need to be the best. I didn't even need to be in the middle. It was okay being at the bottom because I was still part of the group. I still made a costume. I still fit in. I still looked good. It was all great. So I don't know why people think they have to always be the best. You don't always have to be the best. Sometimes you can just be. Just be. We love you just the way you are and what you make. I think I'm going to end this video here for tonight and pick up tomorrow's video, Friday of Costume College. Thank you for joining me and please make sure you're eating your chocolate cake because chocolate cake is good. Okay, you can come now. Oh my gosh, you need love. Look how cute you are.